Women, sponsored by Georgetown University Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. Thank you for taking the time to join us today. My name is Emily White, and I'm the Assistant Director of Alumni Career Services here at Georgetown. And our presenter today is Ann Joan, President and Founder of Piton. To begin, I'd like to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded. You can access the replay of this webinar in 3 business days on our website. There are 2 audio options. You can listen via your computer speakers or dial into the conference bridge number provided. Participants are not required to have a headset, but you are welcome to use one. It is important to note if you experience audio difficulties while listening via your computer speakers, this can be caused by having multiple software applications open. Feel free to close some of these applications or join us using the conference bridge number provided in your reminder email. Questions are welcome. Please type in your questions in the question area of the GoToWebinar control panel screen. Ann is planning to answer as many questions as time will allow, and will also allow attendees to center any questions afterwards that were not answered. We will be emailing out the PowerPoint slides shown during today's presentation. If you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area if possible. Without further ado, I'd like to present our introduce our presenters today. Ann Jones is a knowledge expert in career education and program management with over 18 years of recruiting and career education experience in the corporate and nonprofit sectors. As Assistant Dean and Director of Georgetown's MBA Career Management, Ann increased the number of MBA students with accepted offers to 98%, up from 63%. At Citigroup, she rebuilt a prestigious management training program in New York and led the creation of an internship program for Asia. Ann founded Piton, Inc., with the goal of providing men and women who are experiencing career change with the same professional development that is taught at elite business schools such as Georgetown. Ann has taught veterans and other career changes around the country. She coached at the Student Veterans of America National Conference and will be a speaker and facilitator at this year's Hire America's Employers Symposium. Ann does resume and career coaching in the Washington metro area, New York, and Pittsburgh. I'd like to thank Ann so much in advance for sharing her expertise and time with us today. We have an incredible response from our alums. We had over 260 register for this webinar, so we're thrilled to get started. I'm going to kick it over to you, Ann. Thanks so much.
Hey, thank you so much, Emily. It's always fun to be back at Georgetown, even if I'm back through the internet. The success for today's event, or the goals for today's event, is to have a positive point of view about negotiations, to be more likely to negotiate in the future, and more prepared and more positive negotiation outcome. So that's what I'm shooting for in today's class, and I hope that's what you're shooting for as well. I'm going to be talking about negotiation in general. I'll be talking about specifically how we negotiate in terms of salaries, job changes, as well as negotiating with difficult people, otherwise known as how to negotiate with a jerk. But first, I want to talk about negotiating as a woman. The fact is that women don't like to negotiate. This is sort of seen these days through statistical information, and while it's changing, recent studies, and this information comes from a group that I really like called Women Don't Ask, 2.5 times more women than men said that they feel, quote, a great deal of apprehension about negotiating. Men tend to initiate negotiations more often, they say 4 times as often as women. I love this, male metaphors for negotiation. Men talk about negotiation in terms of a ball game or a wrestling match. Well, women were more likely to pick going to the dentist as a way to describe negotiation. And this is a really horrible one. Women will pay as much as $1,353 to avoid negotiating the price of a car. So these are the facts out there. And I have to say, in my experience, both on the employer side as well as the career management side, I did see a lot of women who were happy to get the job they had and didn't feel like they needed to negotiate. They liked the offer they got. And certainly women who didn't negotiate were far more likely to be women who were changing jobs, women who were going from one industry to another, one function to another, There were a number of women more than men, who would say to me, well, let me master the job, and then I'll negotiate for a higher salary. Well, the fact is that women suffer when they don't negotiate. This statistic, which comes from the book Women Don't Ask, is by not negotiating a first salary, an individual stands to lose more than $500,000 by the age of 60, which is just mind-boggling. But it does make sense when you think about the fact that if you don't negotiate that first salary and everything is, all your raises or increases are based on that starting number, you can sort of see how it happens. There was a study that I thought it was interesting with graduate students at Carnegie Mellon, where they said that 8 times as many master's students who were men, 8 times as many men as women graduating from the Carnegie Mellon program negotiated their salaries. And the men who negotiated were able to increase their starting salaries by an average of 7.4%, or about $4,000. So when you think about that statistic, that more men than women are asking for higher salaries, negotiating for more in the beginning, many of them are starting at a very different point of departure. And another study calculated that women who did negotiate consistently for their salaries, increases were up to $1 million during the course of their careers. $1 million more than women who didn't negotiate. So there's a lot to be said for being more comfortable with negotiation. Before I go any farther, I want to make sure that we're sort of on the same page of what is the definition of negotiation. So the general definition of negotiation would be bargaining, a give and take process between two or more parties, each with its own aims, needs, and viewpoints, seeking to discover a common ground and reach an agreement to settle a matter of mutual concern or to resolve a conflict. Now you'll notice I put a picture of a pie up here on the screen, one, because I like food, but also I do think that we often, when we talk about negotiation, we do think about it in terms of maybe sharing a piece of pie. And I think it's important when we think of the definition of negotiation to remember that sometimes in negotiation there is a set piece of pie, and the bigger my piece is, the smaller your piece is, but not always. You know, in a positive negotiation, it can be win-win, where both parties together can feel like they've had a bigger piece of pie. So that concept is something that I like to think about. So negotiation, try it, you'll like it. I am going to challenge all of you out there to, in the next week or so, to choose something to negotiate that you otherwise would not. If it's even negotiating to get 2 green beers instead of 1 on St. Patrick's Day, which is coming up Thursday. Negotiating in buying a car, negotiating in going to the farmer's market. Whatever it is, try something that maybe you would have otherwise not decided to negotiate, and give it a whirl. And also, for your next negotiation, think about raising your goals just a little bit and see what happens. Now, before we go further into negotiation, we have talked about the definition. I want to go over a few terms that are used in talking about negotiation that I find really helpful to sort of understand it from an academic perspective. So we'll go over some negotiation terms and procedures. The first is the term called BATNA, B-A-T-N-A, which in negotiation theory, BATNA stands for Best Alternative to a Negotiated Agreement. So BATNA is the course of action that will be taken if the current negotiations fail and an agreement cannot be reached. So BATNA is not your lowest number. BATNA is what you're going to do if you're not going to negotiate. So understanding your BATNA is really, I would say, the driving force between all successful negotiators. Understanding what is your best alternative to a negotiated agreement. Now, there are other parts of understanding it. Above the BATNAM, we have the need. And when I say need, that's not your bottom walk-away decision if it's a salary or a business proposition. It's something you, it is the number or the end result that is going to be satisfying to you. You need it to be satisfying. You need it to be better than your BATNA. And ego is the number that you'd really like to get. If it's a salary, it's a number you're going to be very proud of. But the need is what you need to be happy with your decision. And BATNA, again, your best alternative to a negotiated agreement is when is it good to not negotiate at all. So that's one term. The other term I want to share with you is called ZOPA, Zone of Possible Agreement. So ZOPA is it's the part between what you want and what I want. So let's say, for instance, I want to sell my Subaru, and for $15,000, if I could sell it, I would have made one sweet deal. If I sell my Subaru for $10,000, I've gotten enough money to pay off my other bills, and I can maybe buy a moped. If I can't sell the car, for more than $8,000, then it's in my best interest to keep my car. You, on the other hand, need a car. If you could get my car for $5,000, you could afford to spend that extra money going skiing or taking the summer off. At $9,000, you're still going to have a pretty good deal. If you go up to $10,000, you're going to probably say, I'm going to stick with my old beat-up car and wait till I get a better deal. So that part in between, what I want and what I'm going to walk away with, what I won't sell the car for, and what you want and what you'll walk away with, that is the zone of possible agreement. And so that's what we're trying to get to. Understanding what your expectation is as the buyer of my car, what my expectation is, will help us understand what that zone of possible agreement is. Now, there's one more term I want to share with you, and that's called the anchor. Now, the anchor, and I like my little visual here, an anchor is basically, it's your stake in the ground. And it's the anchor is the first reasonable offer. So if you have your expectations and I have my expectations, the party making the first reasonable offer, or the anchor, should prevail over the bargaining partner because the next person has to respond. And so when you look at the equation of what a negotiation looks like, and this is sort of more negotiation theory, but I think it's kind of interesting, when you look at the negotiation equation, I find it good to think in terms of what's the buyer's expectation, the seller's expectation, or my expectation, your expectation. What are both of our BATNAs? What are our best alternatives to a negotiated agreement? And what's a possible anchor that you can put down? So understanding some of those theories, now I'm going to talk a little bit about how can we prepare to negotiate. And preparing to negotiate, the key thing we want is to find how can we find something that's mutually beneficial and a durable agreement. And I stress the word durable. If you negotiate and you win big, but the negotiation doesn't last, then you haven't won at all. So to reach mutually beneficial and durable agreement, the key thing is to ascertain the interests, preferences, priorities, needs, desires, constraints, strengths and weaknesses of the other party as well as of our own. So that preparation is really understanding what do they want, what is their BATNA, and as well as what is ours. And so for this, for a little memory device, I have put up the ABBA song, Knowing Me, Knowing You. So if anybody is at least my age or older, knows this ABBA song in the original, or if you're younger, you probably know it from Mamma Mia. But if you can remember Knowing Me, Knowing You before you go into a negotiation, I think that will help. Besides, it's a great song. Okay, back to preparing to negotiate. First of all, an agreement must be reached that must be better than no agreement at all, right? That is what you're searching for. Above that, above your BATNA, you have your bottom line or your reserve price. You plan your opening offer, your demand, otherwise known as your anchor. And then you plan the number of bargaining moves or concessions you're willing to make in advance. So that's how the sort of the preparation goes. One key thing that I would say to everyone who is preparing to negotiate is write everything down. I've got some handouts in terms of worksheets that I'm going to give to Emily White, and she'll be sending out to you, that I find that could be helpful in helping you write these things down. But before you go into a negotiation, if you can get on paper all these details, you will be much better prepared and more confident in your negotiation. And then begin the dance of negotiation. And you know, the dance, again, it begins with the anchor. Puts that first step down, and the dance ends at the midpoint between the first two reasonable offers. A rule of thumb that I find interesting is each concession tends to be half the size of the previous concession and takes twice as long to be made. And for this reason, I always say get all your facts out on the table and always negotiate, make sure you're negotiating the big things early if you can. It's also important here, I think, to talk a little bit about culture. And this is not just a gender thing. This is more of an American thing. And that's discomfort with negotiation. We as Americans are not comfortable staying in negotiations for a lengthy period of time. And there are other cultures. I don't know if any of you have ever traveled, let's say, to a place like Turkey and watched people negotiating buying carpets. There are some cultures that don't feel as if they've even begun bargaining until three or four sets of offers have been set down. We, as Americans, usually become uncomfortable when we reach about three sets of offers. And so that's why when you're stepping into this dance of negotiation, it's really important to begin as close to where you hope to end. And so again, it begins with the anchor. It begins with doing your preparation, knowing an anchor to put down that will be as close to your final answer. Now I'm going to move forward to, we've talked about sort of, you know, what negotiation is, and we've talked about the equation of negotiation and negotiation theory and the dance of negotiation. So what I'd like to talk about now is one type of negotiation, and that is salary negotiation. I'm very pleased to say that salary negotiations are certainly becoming more important than they it becomes more important than they were even a year ago. As somebody who's been in the career world quite a bit, I have seen a number of people who have been getting new jobs recently, as well as a number of people who have called me to get referrals. And so if that's sort of a leading indicator, I think it looks like in terms of getting new jobs, and I'm knocking on wood as I say that the tide is beginning to turn. And I hope that's the truth. And so I certainly hope and expect that many of you will be going into salary negotiations either for a raise in your current job or for looking into a new job. So I'm going to walk through salary negotiations a little bit. A couple of key things to remember when you're thinking about a salary negotiation. I would say the number one thing about a salary negotiation is that this is not the end of the interview process. It's the beginning of the employment relationship. for so long, the offer was your singular goal. All you wanted to do was get that job offer or get that offer of a new position in your current company. And once you get that, there is a tendency to celebrate and forget that there's still work to be done. Your employer is hoping that you'll accept the invitation either to take on a new role within your company or to join their company. They've already seen you. They've already gotten to know you. You've been interviewing. They can always already see you in the job. And so one of the key things is to remember when you're going into that negotiation that you want your post-offer behavior to be congruent with your interview behavior. You want to negotiate as the same person you were that they wanted to hire. I think there are some people that sort of say you need to be a tough guy when it comes to negotiating. You can negotiate hard and still keep that same personality that got you the job offer in the first place. Nobody wants to end a job offer, having it end in a sort of a bitter a bitter relationship. Now, negotiation begins the minute one side wants something the other is willing to grant. Now, this is kind of interesting when you come to salary negotiations, because if you've been interviewing for a job, you've been applying for the job, it's been sort of one-sided in many ways. You want it, they've got it. Now the tables have turned. They want you. So you've got it, they want it. So now again, this negotiation is beginning to turn, and you want to think about it that one side wants something and the other side may not be ready or may be ready to grant. But finally, you're not adversaries, you're collaborators, especially in salary negotiations. And your mutual goal is a win-win situation. You're going to be working with these people. So let's look at a couple of things that we want to do. Number one is pace yourself. We do tend to want to jump the gun. We want to get it over with. And I think that's just a very normal human feeling. I've been working so hard to get this job. I've got it. I really don't want to deal with any of this negotiation. Let me just sign and start the job. And I think it's important to stop and take a deep breath before you jump into that. And one of the ways that I would recommend that you're doing this is to seek to expand the conversation, explore possibilities. When someone gives out a job offer or a new salary offer, that is the time to, instead of saying yes or no, ask a few questions. This sounds great. Could you provide me some more information about what this might look like? And again, back to that preparing, know what success means to you. Know what the salary number and the benefits number means to you. The next part of preparing for salary negotiations is doing your homework. And hopefully you have been doing this while you've been interviewing for that job in the first place. Once you get the offer, you evaluate each part of the package, of the job package, and prepare your information on it. And again, I've got a worksheet that I'll send out that I find helpful. But in terms of preparing, I think it's a good time to sort of chunk that up, the offer that you're getting, and make sure that you're not overlooking anything. I tend to put it into monetaries, near monetaries, and non-monetaries. So when you get an offer, first of all, it's the monetaries. What are the things that are going to immediately count towards your bottom line? What is the base salary? And remember, the base salary is always better than the signing bonus, because the base salary is something to negotiate from going forward. So there's the base salary, promised increases, and of course a promise An oral promise is only worth the paper it's written on. So promised increases in writing, bonuses promised in writing, sign-on bonuses, profit sharing plans, stock options. These are all monetary items. And you can add them up and put them onto your budget and sort of see how they work out. The second thing is what we call the near monetaries. They're not necessarily immediately on the bottom line, but they will have an impact. What are the benefits? And today, that's certainly important. What are the health benefits? What types of benefits are out there? Is it just health? Is it just medical? Is it medical, dental? Also, eye care. What about overtime, comp time? Is there a company car? What is the travel expectations? Are they going to relocate you? How much will they do that for? All of these things are near monetaries, should be counted up. And remember, when you're counting them up, you're not only counting for what you want, you're counting for what you could possibly trade away. So the more you know what the offer is, the more you know what you can sort of seek to bargain with. And then finally, they're the non-monetaries. Title, training, education, access to technology, getting to choose your travel assignments, being able to work from home, time flexibility. For all of these, get them listed out, and then prepare to begin your negotiations. So once you've done your homework and you've been able to get some time, you've paced yourself, the next step is to choose your timing. And again, there's no one-size-fits-all answer, but the general wisdom is that you should discuss your salary as close to the offer as possible, because only then will you fully understand the entire value of the opportunity. Now, also in terms of timing, and again, this is something that you see quite a bit. When you get one job offer, you often get another one at the same time. Or you might be in the midst of interviewing with three companies and one has made an offer and you're not through with the other two. So before you even negotiate for salary, one of the things you might find yourself negotiating for is time. I would always recommend, when it comes to salary negotiations, looking at a new position, see if you can close out those other two, if you have other opportunities. Keep going through with those other opportunities. You certainly don't want to lead someone on, and you need to be honest. You don't want to lead someone on that you're going to take a job when you're already in negotiations with someone else. But if your best alternative to the negotiated offer, if your best alternative is those other two jobs, you certainly don't want to drop them. So first of all, choose your timing. And the second thing is own the negotiation from the start. I think this is really important. You're setting the situation here. One part of owning the negotiation, and it's a mistake that many people make, is making sure you own who you're negotiating with. The last thing you want to do is to get through a negotiation, be it a salary negotiation or any other business negotiation, and the other partner say, well, let me speak to my manager. So own the negotiation from the start. The other thing is give yourself some quiet time. After you've gone through the negotiation, you've talked about the salary you want, you've talked about benefits, you don't need to have the company car, but you would like instead to have 4 weeks of vacation rather than 3 weeks vacation. Once you come to your decision, give yourself some quiet time. Even if it's only a couple of hours, it is always in your best interest to stop, think things through, talk them out, and then call back or write back with your answer. Employers expect that, and it's absolutely fine. That being said, make your decision promptly. There's no reason to hold out just for the sake of holding out. If you know that you want to make, if you know you want to accept the end of the negotiations, go for it. Like I said, I would leave at least a couple of hours. Let me get back to you in the afternoon. But there's no need to string them along. And this comes back to the idea that you are having a relationship, and hopefully it will be a long relationship. And finally, accept in writing. If you've been negotiating for a different title, anything that's outside of a salary, make sure you get that in writing. You can put that in your acceptance letter. As we've discussed, I will not be accepting the company car, but I will be having the 20 days vacation rather than the 15 days vacation. Have that in writing. This will definitely be important, as well as the fact that people change, and so the person who made that offer may not be the person is going to be making the final decision. Now, it's interesting when you make, you know, the advice for benefit salary negotiations when you're in your current job. When you're in your current job, it is important to find out. Most companies do have a certain time of the year, is often in the fall when salaries are discussed. And so it is important to find out when is that time for your company. I would recommend if you're looking for salary increases in your own company, the first thing you want to begin to ask for is make sure you're asking for a time for an annual or twice annual review. When you can get that on the table, then you've got a situation where you can ask for something. And so I would, for many people, for instance, actually at Georgetown, we have that time for having our annual review in the spring. Salary and increased decisions are made in the fall. Therefore, it is time you want to have that decision, have that conversation in good time for your boss, your manager, the organization to actually make a change. So again, that's where doing your homework can really make a big difference. But definitely if you can get an annual review or a formal review from your manager or from the person that you're reporting to, it gives you a better situation to talk about improvement and to talk about how to get that review or how to get that salary increase. I just wanted, before I go over negotiation rules of the road, I just want to read a couple of sort of phrases that I find are helpful with salary negotiations. Because sometimes I know what I want to say, but it's hard to sort of figure out the words. So here are a couple of things that I hear people say that I think works. One is just in the acceptance of the proposal. I've carefully reviewed your proposal. May I share my comments and ask some clarifying questions? Going back to that, pace yourself. Thank you, I received this. I'd like to ask some questions. Or I understand that you're suggesting $100,000 as a starting base salary. May we discuss the possibility of improving this piece of the package? Again, placing that word out. Also, I find that because we don't want to look a gift horse in the mouth, we want to sort of make sure that we're talking in a less than emotional way. So, for instance, quote, I'm very pleased to be at the stage in the process, and my mindset is primarily enthusiasm. Right now, I need to operate from a mindset of financial responsibility. The base salary that I accept now will anchor my salary progression. and may have an exponential impact on my future earnings. And I want to be responsible about establishing the correct base salary to start with. So that sort of sense, I think, can be helpful. So some negotiation rules of the road. Number one, absolutely, is be prepared. The best prepared party generally has the upper hand in negotiations, be there salary negotiations or any other business negotiation. And being a prepared party means that you have clearly developed objectives, so you know what is important, and you know what you can compromise, and you know what you can't compromise. It's also learning everything about the other side. If it's hiring, knowing do they have another candidate that they can go to easily. Trying to anticipate what their objectives are, what's the most important for them, and trying to sort of walk in their shoes. And again, trying to anticipate those areas of disagreement and thinking ahead of time on what kind of alternatives that you can have before you go to the negotiation table. Second rule of the road, as I said before, is negotiate with the decision makers. And that can be critical. There's nothing worse than you've made great progress and then you find out that the person that you've been negotiating with has no authority to actually, you know, make the decision whatsoever. So make sure that you're negotiating with the person that can actually make the decision. The third is get all the issues on the table before compromising. This is a negotiating tactic that I see people do use, is they try to pick away with small things, and then suddenly you realize that you've negotiated everything away without getting everything you wanted on the table. Much better to get all the issues out there that you want to talk about and then begin to talk about compromise. Generally, if it's a salary negotiation, the first thing you negotiate is the base salary itself. That will have the biggest impact. I'm just stopping to look at a question, and I'm going to, I see that there are a couple questions that just came in, and I'm going to answer them at the end. So the number four is be truthful. As someone who's worked in human resources, I have seen bad behavior on both sides in salary negotiations, and it does not come out pretty in the end. Don't make, people will bluff. People will say there's someone else who wants the position. People will say, I have two other offers. It will come back to haunt you. And so I would definitely always say, you'll be more successful in the long term if you are truthful. Number five is listen and look carefully. When we talk about gender differences, one of the things that people have generally said about women is that they're better listeners and they're more attentive to detail. If you're negotiating in person, make sure you're using the skills that you have there. What are they saying? What are they not saying but giving away with their body language? It will help. It will help you. Make sure you know what your openings are. Treat the other party with respect. This is kind of a no-brainer, but I think it's important to be said. I think some people do tend to think that negotiation only works if you're sort of like some kind of tough guy and threaten or belittle the other person. That really only works if you're never going to see that person again or see that party again. So if you're in a negotiation where you say, well, I'm never going to be in front of this person again, we'll never cross paths, well, maybe you can consider that. But generally, I would work on the idea that it's a small world and you will run into the same parties or groups again. Be sure each party understands the other. And again, this is where I think communication skills can really be to your best advantage, especially for women. Well, I say one of the ways that you can do this is just repetition. Let me make sure I understood you. You said that we are going to do this, the sort of echoing back. Again, this plays to our cultural lack of comfort with negotiating. Sometimes if something is fuzzy, we just want to agree and go on. But if you can do the repetition, just to make sure I know that we're on the same page, we agreed on this and we're moving forward on this. So repeating can help. Understand again who needs the deal most. And I think that's something that comes from up to the number one. Who is the most prepared? You're going to know who needs the deal most. And that will help you understand making an offer and putting down your anchor. Be prepared to compromise. I would say that people, especially for higher salary jobs and for more complex negotiations, the more items that you can list on your list of items that you know you can compromise on, the better you're going to be. So, and then finally, be unemotional. And again, I think this is an important one for women because, to be frank, there are prejudices out there. People will try to pounce on that sense of subjectivity or emotion. When you're talking, and this is something that really can drive an employer crazy, when you're talking about your salary, you want to be able to talk about it in the unemotional and merit-based terms. I would like to get this salary raise because this is how much more money I bring to the company. People do not want to pay more because they feel sorry for you. And so to say, I've had a really tough year, or to say, I have three kids and it's made it very tough for me as a single parent to do this, or anything that's going to be subjective is not going to work in your favor. And it can make people close up on negotiations. So be very careful with the emotions, and be very careful that you're talking from a sense of reason. One of the things that you can do in terms of because there have been a couple of questions coming in about finding out who is the decision maker, is to walk through the process from the beginning. I'm looking forward to talking about the salary. After we talk about the salary, if we agree here, will this be the salary, or is there another step that needs to be taken? So just putting it right out there, can you walk me through what the process will be? We're going to talk about salary and the compensation package. Afterwards, what is the next step? Will we sign, or is there another step? And so I think there are ways that you can sometimes do that. You can ask that question without being so blunt as to say, hey, do you have any power here at all, or am I just talking to somebody who doesn't, know what they're doing? Okay, here's another negotiation type. We've talked about negotiation equation. We've talked about sort of the dance of negotiation, and we've talked about salary negotiation. So now I want to talk about negotiating with difficult people, otherwise known as how to negotiate with a jerk, because they're out there. And so to sort of negotiating with difficult people, here are some of the things that you see with difficult negotiators, because you can't always choose who you're going to be working, negotiating with. Difficult people often subdivide concessions, into dividing issues into smallest parts and sort of picking and picking and picking. They often, difficult people, also known as jerks, can make hypothetical offers that they'll back out of later on. So what if we upped your salary to $125,000, even though they knew that they never were going to do that? They often respond, they often can be sort of very, very stubborn and not be open to any sort of negotiation or any sort of cooperation. Again, dealing with jerks, one of the best things is preparation, right? Know what their need is, how badly do they need to get their side of the negotiation. Really, so much of it comes down to knowing what your BATNA is and trying to understand what their BATNA is. And at the end of this webinar, I've got a list of books, and one is by a woman named Sheila Heen, which I think is fantastic, which talks about negotiating or working with difficult people. So negotiating with jerks. A lot of what I recommend in negotiating with jerks is, again, what I call mirroring, right? So finding a cooperative response to difficult people. They're picking apart. You find pieces that you can build up with, right? So if they're trying to get you to agree to this concession and that concession, see if you can break it down further so two can play that game. So I often recommend if they're trying to push you on a concession, be it salary, time off, try to break it down. And so instead of it's a yes, no, you can try to offer, what if we do part of this? They make hypothetical offers. You too can make hypothetical offers. You can fly a flag past them, and as long as you use the terms what if. Well, what if I agreed to $125,000 but only took 2 weeks' salary? Do call jerks on the carpet. Without being a jerk yourself, let them do more of the talking. If they're throwing a number out that you think they've put down an anchor that's just unreasonable, ask them to justify their decision. Or could you give me more information as to how you came to this number or how you came to this fact? Putting the word on them, putting the work on them can be helpful here. And then finally, this sort of mirroring. We tend to, and this isn't just women, I think a lot of us tend to, we often try to attack intransigence or stubbornness. We try to attack it by offering more. If I show them cooperation, maybe they'll be more cooperative with me. The fact is that oftentimes the best way to deal with somebody who's being stubborn is to be stubborn yourself. And so, you know, you hold your line, they hold their line. That sort of mirroring. And that mirroring can be in your language as well. Finally, negotiate from strength. Robert Rubin said, and I like this, when others sense your willingness to walk away, your hand is strengthened. Sometimes you're better off not getting to yes. And again, this comes back to what is your best alternative to the negotiated agreement. Now, I want to share with you some words of wisdom from other women. Some of this is pulled off of a couple of different websites, these pieces, and it's not all my sort of my ideas, but certainly other women who have written in about negotiating. And so I think it's interesting to sort of share what other women have seen. And one that comes up in many different people writing about negotiating for women is they say the gender relationship needs to be top of mind in business negotiations. The fact is that women and men do communicate differently, and they have different expectations, and so that you do need to keep that in mind. I'm going to mention her at the end, but I want to share her name now. I don't know how many of you know or have met Deborah Tannen. She's a professor at Georgetown, and she's written a couple of great books as well as written some really cool articles about gender and communication. And I will also have that at the end as some recommended reading. The other thing that a lot of women have said is use mentors to help refine your negotiating skills. And this is absolutely crucial if you haven't negotiated in a while. There is nothing better than actually having the words come out of your mouth, especially if you're asking for something that you're not particularly comfortable with. So as much as you know what you're going to say and you're writing it down in your head, if you're going in to negotiate for something that you might feel uncomfortable about, get a good friend and say, just listen to me say these words. Having the words come out of your mouth is going to help. The other thing that women say is women tend to think of getting along versus getting what they want. And I think that's quite common. And I think that there's often a misunderstanding that you, in order to get along, you have to give up getting everything that you want or getting what you want. And so I think it's interesting that a lot of women put that down as a challenge. Now negotiation, this is another thing that women write in, I think it's also very interesting, is negotiation is a conversation and you may risk getting off track. And that's true, and again, this comes back to the preparation and writing down on paper what you want. Gaining buy-in along the way will get you closer to your goal faster. Successful negotiation requires preparation. I like this. It's not always about the money, and a lot of women wrote that in about money is not the only thing you negotiate for. As I said in the beginning, because women do not negotiate about salary or money as much, there is a long-lasting impact about that. But that isn't to say that money is the only thing. And putting down your monetaries, your near monetaries, and your non-monetaries will help you make sure that you're negotiating for everything that's important. Be prepared to compromise. Being fair is not a loss. And negotiation is a process. It's not an event. And the more you're comfortable with this ongoing process, I think the more successful you will be. So in summary, negotiation is something that I hope you all go out and do soon. Find something that you want to negotiate and go out and do it and practice some of these things. The more you know your competitors' motivations, concerns, preferences, desires, needs, priorities, risk tolerance, their optimism, pessimism about the future, know your own as well. The more you know what they want and know what you want, it comes back to that ABBA song, knowing me, knowing you, the better you will be. Know what your best alternative is to a negotiated agreement. So know what's out there if you're not going to negotiate, and know what is out there for the other side as well. Plan your opening offer, and that is your anchor. So again, decide what you want based on your preparation, and try to put that anchor down. Think of the number of bargaining moves that you're willing to make and plan them in advance. Again, get it written down. And finally, keep your emotions in check. It's an emotional thing, especially if you're talking about a new job. So pace yourself. Now, finally, I want to share again with you some recommended reading. Now, there are a lot of great books about negotiation. Getting to Yes, which is the second from the bottom on this list, is a great one. It's sort of a classic book on negotiations, and I think it's pretty good. But there are a couple of others that you may not know about that you might get, that you might find interesting. There are two websites up here. One is careerwomen.com, and the other is womendontask.com. I think they're interesting. I think they have some insights that you don't always see in other books, and so I recommend them. The bottom of this list is a book called Difficult Conversations, written by a woman named Sheila Heen out of Harvard University. I think she's terrific, and I think this book is great. It's great for negotiations as well as any other kind of difficult conversation. And I think she's got a really interesting sort of spin on looking at things. And then finally, the second on this list is Deborah Tannen, who's a Georgetown professor. She's written a number of books. She's been on a number of talk shows. I just put down here one article which I liked. It's pretty scholarly, but I thought it was really well written, which is called The Power of Talk, Who Gets Heard and Why. Which is a Harvard Business Review. And I'm not sure if she has it on her website, but if you go to the Georgetown, main Georgetown website, I think you can probably find more information on Deborah Tannen there. And like I said, I think she's particularly interesting. So I want to thank you all for your time. I really enjoyed talking about negotiations, and I really think that there's nothing better than being over-prepared for a negotiation and having it come out in a really positive way. I'm going to answer just a couple of questions. I think I have just 2 minutes left. Is that right, Emily?
Yep. Unfortunately, we only have 2 minutes left.
Oh, me and my big mouth. I'm going to answer a couple of quick questions. And then I see that there are other questions up here, and I will put them in one of two places. Certainly, you can see on this last page, my website is pitoninc.org, and I have a blog up there. And so oftentimes, especially when there's a good question that would be important for a lot of people to know the answer to, I'll put that in the blog. So do go to pitoninc.org and check out the blog. As well as I can follow up, if it's an individual question, I will follow up with Emily on that. One of the questions somebody wrote in, which I think is very interesting, is how can you know the other person's background? How can you understand what they want? A lot of this comes from you can know a lot just by doing more preparation and asking yourself those questions. If you're looking for a job these days, if you've been offered a job, what is the other person's best alternative? You know, are you do you think you are the best person for this job? Do you know that there are other people out there for that job? So a lot of it comes from preparation. There are also, and I'll put that on there, in terms of salaries and stuff like that, you know, are you in the right sort of level? There are good salary calculators and other things that I think can be helpful. So again, I will follow up with some of these questions online. I want to thank all of you for your great attention, and a big thanks to Georgetown's Alumni Association. If this is your first webinar that you've taken with Georgetown, I hope it won't be your last. Bridget Bowers and Emily White do a phenomenal job, and thanks so much to them. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Anne. This has been phenomenal. We'll be sending out a follow-up email with the webinar slides and details on our other upcoming webinars. And I'll also CC you, Anne, on that email so folks can reach out if needed. But thanks so much, and we hope everyone has a great day.